getting Archangel into print is that comics were my first medium, period. But kind of unusually, it wasn't comics as they were in the early 1950s when I first encountered them. It was that I couldn't, in elementary school, I was having real trouble learning to read initially. I can't really remember the trouble, but I know historically when I was having it. And my mother's intuitive solution to this was to give me her Hogo anthology books. Walt Kelly Simon & Schuster used to publish all of the Walt Kelly Hogo strips in these big, wonderful paperback editions. And she gave them to me, and I think she probably read them to me. So I fell in love with this super sophisticated, hyper-political, beautifully drawn cartoon. It was just a completely immersive universe, and I remained a massive Pogo fan until puberty or something, where other things got my attention. And I think that actually was my real education, acculturation in media, because when I read comics as comics, it was DC, it was pre-Marvel. I was sort of not reading mainstream comics by the time Marvel arrived in the mainstream. I was reading Mark Crumb and Zap comics. So I'm kind of weirdly impoverished. Or I like to think of myself as I'm an alien, but it's kind of in a way that's kind of valuable. So I'm working with a new medium. Autobiographical. In 1967, when Sergeant Pepper and the first Velvet Underground movie came out, there was a lot of very iconic music out. And purely by accident, I happened to stay somewhere where it was a worn-out copy of a collection of Lotte Lenya singing Bertolt Brecht in English. And the only song that I ever heard was Back for Night, which I knew in that kind of saccharine pop version from my childhood. But when I heard Lotte Lenya sing it and the rest of the stuff, it completely blew my mind. So I had this weird thing happen to me where Lotte Lenya singing Bertolt Brecht became part of my soundtrack from 1967. And I never really forgot it. And it sort of opened the doorway into modern, some of the other downside or maybe upside, depending on how you look at it, of modern German culture. And that's what I imagine playing in the back of the scenes with Mr. Baby, who's called that by the English characters, but in my German pronunciation is not existent, but in German. A German friend tells me he would be Herr Sackling, or Mr. Sackling. He's a cross between an adult-sized baby and the young Peter Lorre.
And the thing
think I read it voraciously for 4 or 5 years in my early teens, which at that time was considered by some genre SF publishers to be the demographic. Like, that's who they were shooting for. And then, puberty came along, and counterculture happened, one thing and another. And I was reading less SF. By the early 70s, I found myself late in life, English honors undergrad student at the University of British Columbia, studying English literature. And I learned about naturalism, which is literary naturalism, which is an early modern idea that we take it very much for granted now. We don't even notice it's there. It's akin to realism, but it's different sort of thing. So not only is it how people are, but it's why they are the way they are. And it started in the early 19th century with some couple of French brothers, but never mind. Anyway, I came to understand naturalism as doing that undergraduate work, and I realized that a lot of the science fiction that had really worked for me in my heyday as a science fiction reader had been science fiction that had a strong naturalistic element. But simultaneously, a lot of the stuff that had worked for me had been science fiction that had a strong surrealist element. And I realized that I for instance, been really, really amazed by William Burroughs, who sort of hijacked science fiction memes and surrealism to produce these crazy, intense beat era works like Naked Lunch, which were in a way the cutting edge modernism of their day. And I was having these thoughts in the mid-1970s. And I started looking at the science fiction that was around on the stands in the bookstores in the 1970s, and I was trying to read it. It wasn't doing much for me. I thought, well, what happened? There was Roger Zelazny and Samuel R. Delaney and Michael Moorcock and J.G. Ballard Joanna Russ, and all this stuff that was really, really happening. I felt like somebody who had grown up on really good country swing, being forced to listen to Nashville country. I didn't feel like science fiction. I thought science fiction would fall way off and turn into a Bible pop artifact. And as soon as I realized that was the first inkling I ever had that it might be cool to try to write science fiction. It's like if you found a post office in your town that you loved as a kid was actually standing deserted, and you'd go kind of, it had waves there. and that was my first thought. So I think that what the man who asked the question that I've taken so long to try to answer, the answer I'm trying to make is that I think you're responding, in the characterization, you're responding to naturalism. That I let them be people. Mormon is often the case in some.